Hello, once again. Okay. Now, we will discuss DC circuits and resistance, especially the topic of resistance. So, first of which is we need to determine what is a DC circuit. So, what's the definition of that? So, when you say DC, means direct current. DC means direct current. Okay. So, a direct current circuit is a closed path or a circuit wherein it includes a battery, a voltage source, conductor, and a load, which constitute an electric circuit that uses a direct current. Okay? And the main component is resistance. When you say direct current, in terms of signal, okay, the voltage and current with respect to time, okay, is in a straightforward path. So it means the voltage and current, no matter what, they are in the same path or same angle. Okay, so it means no voltage and current, the signal is a straightforward relationship. So, the main component of a DC circuit is resistance. So, what is resistance? So, resistance is an element, an electrical element that denotes the ability to resist any flow of current or electric current. So, we already know the Ohm's law, right? So, the Ohm's law is a voltage is simply equal to the current times resistance I. So V is voltage, I current, R resistance. Okay. So as we can see here that the R, if we interchange the equation here, okay, so it will become like this. And it's pretty clear that the resistance is inversely proportional to the current, which means if you have a higher resistance, okay, you will have a lower current because resistance is the direct opposition of the current. Okay, now, a resistance is also a conductor that is placed between your source and your load. Load has a different resistance voltage as a source. And the formula for a resistance in terms of DC is simply this one, okay? So we have here an alpha here, which constitutes the resistivity of the material, the length, and the total area, which is dt. Okay, we have already established the legends here, though. And the resistivity here that I will tackle on the next few slides is resistivity is the type of material that you will use on the circuit. There are many types of material that you can use. You have an aluminum conductor, you have a copper conductor, you have a steel conductor, you have a carbon conductor, etc. So they have different type of resistivity. So when you say resistivity, it constitutes to the type of material that you will use in the circuit. So that is already a constant parameter. A constant parameter on the circuit. Okay? So it depends on the unit, so we will discuss in the next few slides the things, the types of units that we will use. And it's always on the 20 degree centigrade, the temperature. Always at normal temperature, 20 degrees. Now, we will discuss the resistivity, the typical resistivity of different types of materials, and the length units, as well as the area units. That constitutes for the formula of RDC or DC resistance. Okay, first we need to know the typical resistivities of typical conductors. These are the conductors used on transmission lines. Okay, so the unit can be ohm meter or ohm dash meter or ohm circular mil. C-mil here means circular. Circular mils. Okay, wherein on the long run, circular mils means
area of the conductor.
Okay, so the units on the metric is ohm meter and ohm simul per feet. Sometimes it can be indicated by ohm CMF, means circular mil per feet.
Okay, if you have your notebooks or you can jot down notes, well, it's much better so that you can memorize or you can recall the important formulas. So I box an important formula here because this is already a constant. So these are constants. Okay, so when you say resistivity at 20 degrees centigrade of a copper, that is 1.72 times 10 raised to negative 8 ohm meter or 10.37 ohm circular mil per feet. The resistivity at 20 degrees centigrade at normal temp on aluminum is 2.83 times 10 negative 8 ohm meter or 17 ohm circular mil per feet. Okay, these are constants, so don't forget. Okay, sometimes on some problems, it does not indicate the resistivity, so you need to know the resistivity of a typical conductor, especially copper or aluminum, stable. Now, there are also, you know, the units for length. It is metric, meter, centimeter, millimeter, or in English, mils, feet. So it means a circular mil is a unit of area, while mils is a unit of length. Okay? So area, the unit is metric, in metric units, meter squared, or centimeter squared, or millimeter squared. But in English, you have circular mils, as stated a while ago, feet squared, inch squared, okay? So, there are also some related formulas in terms of circular mils. These units of circular mil, simil, okay, area, mils, okay, length. Okay, these formulas here, okay, are very, very useful, okay, in terms of how you will convert, you know, inch to mil, circular mils, simil, etc. So, always remember, there is 1,000 mils in 1 inch. Pi all over 4 mil square or square mil means you have circular mil. And if you have 1 MCM, is equal to 1,000 circumference. Now, this is not mega simil, but it is mils, circular mils. So that's the meaning of an MCM. Okay, on the next slide, we will discuss other formulas related to circular mils and mils. So let's move forward to the applications of circular mil formulas. Okay, I have two important applications of the circular mil area. Depends on the conductor type. Okay, first, if your circular mil area for a conductor, we have two types of conductor, by the way. You have a circular or a round conductor or pericircular and a non-circular or concentric type. Okay, so if your conductor is a perfect conductor or a round conductor, the formula for the area of simils is simply equal to, you know, whatever the diameter of the conductor, just in terms of mils, by the way, you must convert it to mils, okay, and then you square that diameter, you can obtain the circular mil. Actually, this formula, you know, is based on the concept of a circle that is inscribed on a square. And we can assume, okay, that the size of the square, which is when you compute for the area, square of the side, is simply equal to the diameter. Okay? So, hence, we can now, okay, apply that on perfect conductors, which has an n squared formula. For example, you have four conductors, you have the diameter is 2 mils, or a 3 by 3 or 9 conductors which has a overall horizontal and vertical diameters of 3 mils. Okay. Next is the circular mean area computation for a non-circular or concentric type. So another type of conductor is a non-circular. An example of that is a busbar conductor. So this is a busbar conductor. Busbar. Okay. So a busbar conductor is not a perfect conductor. So that is a rectangular shape. So it means this busbar is in rectangular shape, so you need to compute for the circular mean area of that by using this formula here. So how you will apply this one? Simply, if you have here a rectangular shape, you have the height, the width, and the length, just multiply the height, you know, by the width, and you can now compute for the cross-sectional area of that. Now, please do remember that if the height and the width are in terms of inches, meter, or feet, you need to convert it to mils first, and then you squared it, and then you multiply it by pi all over 4. So it is like converting a square to the area of a circle. Right? So that's the technique. If you have a copper bus bar, which is rectangular shape, so instead of computing the volume, you can compute the cross-sectional area, and then the cross-sectional area can be computed to circular mirrors. Also, we can compute also the circular mirror area of a concentric type or stranded type. This is a 7-strand conductor. Okay, so the technique here is you need to compute first, since again they have the same area, so you need to compute first the strand area first, one strand area, and then you multiply it by 7, which is this 7 strands. Okay, and then you can now get the total area. So, and if you get the total area, then you get the resistance, or L over area total. Now we can solve some sample problems on the next slide. Thank you.